investigation mishaps, which the police messed up on, as well as it tests the validity of our justice system here in America. So, if you're interested in true crime, the basic ASMR, definitely stay tuned and like and subscribe for more content like this. Okay, let's get started. Side note, all of my notes are to the left of me, so if you see me glancing like this, it's because I am reading off of a very long document I curated. Okay, so on Friday, September 9th, 1988, 7-year-old Jaclyn Dowaliby was getting ready for bed in her home in Midlothian, Illinois, which is a suburb outside of Chicago. Even though it was the end of summer, she had a catalog with a marker and was circling gifts she wanted to get her family for Christmas. She put on her favorite nightgown and went to bed clutching the catalog. On Saturday morning, her father David woke up at around 7 a.m. and noticed that the front door was wide open. He didn't think anything of it, simply thought his mother, Jaclyn's grandma, had come home late and forgotten to close the door. So he simply closed it and went to cook breakfast for himself and his son, Davy, who was 4 years old. Now at around 9 a.m., the mother, Cynthia, went to go wake up Jaclyn from her room, but Jaclyn was not in her bed. So they searched the house, but she was not there either. They even called one of her favorite playmates, seeing if she had gotten up early and gone over to play since it was Saturday morning, but the family had said they had not seen her. So the Dowalibis start to panic. They go into search mode, walking up and down the neighborhood, calling her name. But they can't find her, so they go back to the house and do a more thorough search, and they find that a window in the basement has been broken. So at this point, David, the father, calls the police and says, "There has been a break-in and my daughter is missing." So detectives, police officers, and FBI agents converge on the home. Officials assume because of the window there was a kidnapping and that there would be a ransom call and she would most likely be returned. So there wasn't really a push to go out and search for her. They also said in these situations that it was most likely a family member or someone close to the family. So the Dowalibys begin thinking of who it could be. They immediately think it's Cynthia's ex-husband, Jim, who was actually Jaclyn's biological father. He has tried snatching her in the past, but they researched him and he actually was in prison during the time of the kidnapping for sexual assault. So then the next suspect was Jaclyn's uncle, who was the brother of Jim, the ex-husband. Jaclyn's uncle, Timothy Guess, but he had an alibi as well for the night of Jaclyn's disappearance. Timothy, side note, Timothy was diagnosed as a schizophrenic, so he had some mental health issues, and he lived very, very close to the family. So, just some background on the parents. Cynthia worked part-time as a dietitian at a local hospital, and David was a carpenter who had worked his way up to be a foreman on a construction site. He had only missed one day of work in the past 9 years, and that day was missed to adopt Jaclyn as his daughter. Apparently David and Jaclyn were very close, had a very special bond. They did daddy-daughter stuff. They had a very healthy relationship. So, going back to the investigation, police noticed upon further review that the intruder would have they said, wouldn't you be suspicious if your door was open in the morning after you had locked it? And, I mean, whatever. So, a day went by after Jaclyn was reported missing, which is after that 24-hour mark, it starts to get more stressful because most kids usually fall victim to foul play and are usually found dead. Police set up a task force and canvassed the area. So I'm gonna start to go into the mistakes of the investigation that police did, authorities did. So right after it happened, so early on in the investigation, they never like cornered off Jaclyn's room. Slept in the bed that night she was missing. They didn't do a thorough investigation of the house. They didn't do a thorough investigation of the room. They didn't take super close up photos of the basement window, even though that was the only evidence that an intruder had entered the house. They've just taken like kind of far away photos. So only the window and the front door were dusted for fingerprints. Neither of the back doors were, and no other windows were. To make matters even worse, the Dowalibys' friends, like, to help them keep vigil and keep them company while their daughter is missing, they cleaned the house from top to bottom, which makes sense. Stressed, like, I'll clean my room or whatever, but the police kind of just watched them. They didn't do anything. They didn't stop them. They cleaned the house from top to bottom, so any evidence that was there was gone. They even swept up the broken glass that was broken by the basement window in front of police. So, obviously, they had good intentions, but that's investigation for your missing child. So whatever evidence that was left by the intruder was completely gone. So the parents, the Dowalibys, took a lie detector test. David passed, but Cynthia was very upset. So her results were inconclusive. So Saturday night, Jaclyn was still missing. Monday morning, police asked for fingerprints and urine and blood samples, which the Dowalibys readily complied with. The police then decided to question the couple separately, and they found David's responses to be very suspicious because they believed he kept referring to the disappearance as an accident. He was saying, well, the accident. But David insisted later on that he was saying incident and not accident. This is where the parents kind of start to become possible suspects, and the police start to crack down on them. The police start to fear that Jaclyn could have been accidentally killed while being disciplined by her parents, similar to like what people think with the JonBenet Ramsey situation. Apparently on Tuesday, so around 4 days after Jaclyn's gone missing, and evidence technician suggested that the basement window may have been broken from the inside, meaning the parents might have faked the crime scene. They also stated that no fingerprints were on the inside of the window, but they were basing that off of a photograph, which it was like a very poor photograph, and what they were basing it off of just didn't really work. So, 5 days after Jaclyn's disappearance, they asked the parents to take another polygraph. Cynthia's was inconclusive, but on David's, it said that he had lied, so they took him in for questioning. case were still focused on the parents. 2 days before Thanksgiving, police arrested the Dowalibys for the murder of Jaclyn and stated they had killed Jaclyn in the home, and they had 2 eyewitnesses that saw David dumping the body. So the court case came along, but it proved that the evidence the police and prosecution stated they had was far, far weaker than they had put off to the 2 eyewitnesses that the prosecution said they supposedly had seen David dumping the body. Turned out to only be 1. It was a 30-year-old man testifying that he was returning home and he saw a car pull away from the field where the body was dumped. He stated the car was similar to the Dowalibys and even pointed out David Dowaliby in a lineup that was the man he had seen. But the defense pointed out that the witness would have been 75 yards away from the dumping spot, which is 3/4 of a football field, and it would have been dark out. It would have been nighttime, so there's no way the person they saw a face. There's no way you would be able to see a face from that far away, which is true. Like 75 feet is extreme. 75 yards is extremely far. I don't even think I can see a face in the middle of the day from 75 yards away, much less in the middle of the night. So after that, the defense kind of stumbled through their part and failed to connect with the jury, unfortunately, and the jury announced that they found David Dowaliby guilty of first-degree murder, but Cynthia was acquitted. She was not accused of murdering her daughter.
Like that.
So, at the time, two waitresses who had worked at the restaurant supported that alibi, but then they later told police that Timothy had only been there very briefly at around 9:30 p.m. They said they had lied because they believed the Dowaliby parents to be guilty and didn't want to get involved. Several customers who had been there at the restaurant that night, who had never been questioned by police, also said guests had not been there. Timothy Guess, it also came out that he knew a ton of significant information about the case and about the Dowaliby's home that had never come out to the public. He just somehow knew all this information about how what the crime scene looked like and the layout of the Dowaliby's home. So, kind of suspicious, but nothing came of it, and he died in 2002. And the case is still unsolved, and nothing has happened since then. I personally think the parents are innocent, and Timothy Guest did it. Like, to me, that's pretty obvious based off of my research. This case was extremely frustrating to me, starting with the investigation and how it was totally just the evidence was probably destroyed and the police mishandled the crime scene. Yeah, it's very sad the case has to be unsolved because it seems pretty open and shut. It just goes to show how the justice system and the police system can